Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. On this episode of Insight, our life expectancy is increasing, much of that thanks to science. But is there a line between a good life and a long life?
I was never planning to live this long. I was never feeling that I wanted to live longer and longer and longer.
You're taking nearly 500 pills a week. Why are you doing that?
To try to live as long as possible.
Is there a certain personality type that's drawn to anti-aging studies?
I might get in trouble answering that question.
I live each day as if it was my last, and one day I'll be right. Have as much fun every day as I possibly can.
If you've had the opportunity to love and to be loved, then that's pretty much a good life.
I love it on the water. It's any day, any time, even in the rain. It is an outing you look forward to every week. My name is Terry Stannard. I took my life as it came and lived it. And now I'm 95, I'm still living it. I can't walk without pain. But when once I drop in the kayak, I'm off. I can paddle for hours. I know that I have to keep moving. When you rest, you rust. And when you keep mobile, you keep fit. I started the kayaking about 30 years ago. The name of the club is Sanko Seniors Recreational Kayaking Club. Now that recreational means that there is nobody needs to prove anything, and we are not going to be the fastest. And that's how we all like it now. We all love our club because there is no competition. It's the being with friends and enjoying one another while we are on the water doing what we like doing. My husband died in 75, so I came to Australia. That period of my life was not about friends, it was about my family, because I'm a house full with children, and I had a full-time teaching job. I think if you just accept what's coming to you and make the most of it, yeah, that's a full life. I've had a very full life. I've been visiting these trees for 30 years. When I first saw them, they were healthy and beautiful trunks. They were so iconic. And immediately I called them the lovers. It's so obviously that these trees found each other and they hug each other and they're together for the rest of their lives. For the years when I see them growing older and older, and me too, I said, well, I would like my ashes to go here. But now I'm looking at it and I wonder, who's going to be underwater first? Them on me.
Terry, you're 95 years old. You have 9 children, 21 grandchildren, and a few great-grandchildren. What's your secret to living longer?
I was never planning to live this long. I was never feeling that I wanted to live longer and longer and longer. I never did. I enjoyed what life brought me. And I was always very active. I didn't ever have medication. I've never had any medication.
Wow.
The odd times that I had an infection, to clear an infection, I would get something. But never medication.
William, you're 36 years old and you're in very good health, yet you're taking nearly 500 pills a week. Why are you doing that?
To improve my health and try to live as long as possible.
And how are you doing that?
By doing whatever Brian Johnson is currently doing, with a few other additional scientifically proven health benefits.
Who's Brian Johnson?
So he's almost a billionaire, I believe. He spent $2 million a year experimenting with his body.
Brian Johnson is developing a longevity protocol which includes blood plasma transfusions from his teenage son. Yes. Would you consider something like that?
Yeah, I would do that if the science shows that it's beneficial for longevity.
You've been following elements of his blueprint for almost 2 months.
Yes.
What inspired you to do this?
So from a young age, I've always been fascinated in a way about death. Asked my dad and he would point to religion, but it didn't quite make sense to me at the time. And over time, I developed a kind of obsession with living for as long as possible. I just love living. I enjoy life. People think it's the opposite. Like I must fear dying or something bad has happened or traumatized or something. But there's none of that. I just enjoy life. That's why I want to keep living and live for ideally forever, but as long as possible.
As well as taking more than 60 tablets every day, What else do you do to... Actually, I'm just looking at that footage there. When you look at that, like, that's a lot. Is that sort of how your life and days are every day?
Yeah, pretty much every day, unless some medical condition where if something's wrong and a doctor tells me to stop, I'll stop. And then if it's fine again, I'll continue again.
So as well as taking more than 60 tablets every day, what else do you try to do as part of this longevity regime?
So I eat the same meal every day and I eat it once a day and fit it all into one meal.
So one meal a day,
meal
every day?
Yes.
What about exercise?
Yeah, I work out, spend about 2 hours at the gym and then another 30 minutes of cardio and 20 minutes of sauna. Also at night I have cold showers before I sleep, do some red light therapy and meditation.
Mandy, you're William's wife. Yes. What's it like being married to someone who's so devoted to living as long as possible?
It takes a lot of discipline, and I guess he motivates me to live healthier. There's no way I can do what he does. I can't do it at all. Maybe 20% of what he's doing. I feel kind of guilty sometimes if I want Macca's or other junk food and I see him eat healthily and I go, oh, I better not.
So have you changed your behaviour a little bit?
Definitely, yes.
Are you also interested in living for a very long time?
Not as much as him. I can't say I totally the same path, but I get it. But still, I want quality of life as well.
William, has anyone ever said to you, gosh, that sounds a bit extreme?
Yeah, definitely. People online, they're always telling me I'm going to be dead soon, but all my blood results show otherwise.
How do you know if this blueprint you're following is going to work?
I don't think you can know if it's going to work or not. I've done a epigenetic test to see my age, and I'll be doing it maybe every 6 months to see if it reverses to any significant degree.
So if it's working, you're 36, it might say you've got the age of a 32-year-old.
Yeah, and then later on, if I keep following the blueprint and I become younger, then something's happening for sure.
John, in 2012, you were in your mid-50s then and you were diagnosed as pre-diabetic. What did that prompt you to do?
I don't want to live the last 20 years of my life in a nursing home with dementia. So I adopted a low-carb diet and then subsequently a keto diet.
What do you eat on an average day?
I usually don't have what people would call breakfast. So I normally eat at 11 o'clock, would be my first meal of the day. Typically I would have boiled eggs with a sprinkling of salt, turmeric and pepper. And then I would probably only have two meals for the day. Then I would have my second meal probably somewhere between 5 and 6 o'clock.
You're no longer pre-diabetic, but you're still following a ketogenic, known as keto diet, 7 years later. Why are you doing that?
I think the science is quite strong on the fact that chronic inflammation is behind a lot of the problems that we have as we get older. So heart attack, stroke, dementia, cancer. So the keto diet is an anti-inflammatory diet. And as opposed to most diets, you can measure how successful you're being. So I prick my finger most days and measure the main ketone body, which is called beta-hydroxybutyrate, and I aim to have my beta-hydroxybutyrate ketone levels between 1 and 2.
Before your diagnosis, you were a self-described sweet tooth.
Yes.
Is your diet hard to maintain?
Not now. I'm in a habit of eating the way I do.
So if you're thinking, gosh, I wouldn't mind a piece of chocolate,
What
do you do?
I eat macadamia nuts.
Okay.
So I have them in my pocket or the glove box of my car.
Dan, you also recently started a keto diet. How are you finding it?
I just started off with the help of my wife by changing what I was eating and just started walking a couple of hours a day. And initially I found it really easy. I've kind of ambivalent to food anyway, so I can eat almost anything. I could eat the same thing every day if it came down to it. I've got other things of interest to do with my time to think about. So I did really well for a while. And eventually I sort of picked up the testing kits and things like that and got really interested. I started losing weight. Things happened quite rapidly. think I was 105 kilos at the beginning of the year. I'm about 92 at the moment. But what I found was that ignorance is bliss. You don't see the traps coming down the pathway. You know, if you get a little bit sick or you have family events coming up and everyone's having wine and beer and cake and things like that, and you go, oh, I'll just take a break. Mm. And at the moment, I think I'm off the wagon. And my goal is to get back on board as soon as possible.
John, have you lost weight on the keto diet?
Yes, in 2012, for over a couple of years, I lost 16 kilograms.
How do other people respond to your approach to longevity?
Well, I'm part of a community where other people are doing it, so that's a big help.
William, how about you? What do others say about your longevity regime?
Most people think it's quite extreme and it's not going to work or something along those lines generally, yeah.
What do you feel about that when people say it's not going to work?
I think it's kind of strange that people question it when so many other people are just doing other things. When I was eating junk food, no one cared, no one questioned anything. But now that I'm doing something I think it's better and trying doing it properly with supervision as much as possible, I get questions all the time.
Mm. Lindsay, you're an anti-aging researcher. Can we control whether or not we can live a very long life?
One of the earliest findings from this field was that constant calorie restriction can extend lifespan. You know, if you take away 30% of the calories of a rat, they'll live 30 or 40% longer. We thought it was just calorie intake for a long time, but it's now emerged that actually the protein component of diet probably is a stronger determinant of overall lifespan. I know that these paleo diets or Atkins diets or, you know, ketogenic diets have been very popular in recent years. That's largely because people feel full very early on. But the data we have, at least in animals, is that, you know, a high-protein diet shortens lifespan. But that, I think, more important question is maintaining a lifestyle and a lifespan that is enjoyable.
Mm. What about genetics? Do they play a role in how long we can live?
There certainly is a genetic component, but, you know, our genes are not our fate. Genetic variants that seem to be associated with longevity are, if at all, play a very minor role. These environmental factors, exercise and diet, sleep, social interactions, appear to be far more important for how long people live.
And what happens to our bodies as we age in our quest to live longer? What are we trying to stave off?
There is an exponential risk of all sorts of diseases as we grow older. We think about disease risk factors. You know, a classic one would be COVID-19. People I don't think, really understand just how exponential the increase is in the risk of severe disease during COVID-19. People are worried about being immunosuppressed, for example, but actually that risk increase pales into comparison to just being a few years older. Mm-hmm. So what happens to our bodies when we grow older is this increased risk of all of these diseases together all at once. And so what we hope to achieve, rather than living longer, is to decrease the risk of all of these diseases together.
Hugh, you're a GP who's also interested in longevity. How do you feel about the way modern medicine deals with ageing?
One of the ways that modern medicine deals with disease is to treat symptoms when they appear. And the problem with most of the diseases of ageing that we've sort of heard about is that we know that these diseases really start many, many years, probably 20 years or more, before we start to see the symptoms. So we're very good at treating heart disease when it appears. We've got good medications. Some things like Alzheimer's that we're not very good at treating. But we do know that lots of interventions can stave off some of these diseases and allow a healthier and a longer life.
For the last 6 months, you've been taking a drug called rapamycin. What is it?
It's a drug that has been found to be immunosuppressant. It also has anti-cancer functionality. And in the late 90s, it was approved by the FDA for preventing organ rejection in transplant patients. And there was a study in 2009 in mice, and they found that it lengthened the life of the mice. And they actually expected that the mice would probably be killed by this drug because of its immunosuppressant effects. But they actually lived longer, but not only lived longer, but they had far fewer of the diseases of ageing.
You're taking rapamycin even though you're not a transplant recipient.
That's right.
How can something for suppressing the immune system increase your longevity?
You know, there are lots of sort of studies now in mice, 30 or more studies, which show that it doesn't have those kinds of effects. And the way it's used in longevity, it's used at much lower doses. And in fact, there are some human studies, there's not many human studies, but there are human studies that show it actually improves immune function in elderly people.
How do you know how much to take and when to take it?
We don't have the human studies to tell us exactly what the dose is. We're confident that it's, you know, it's pretty safe to use. We know it's been around a long time. We know what the side effects are. And there are a lot of people who are sort of using it off-label around the world now. So, you know, in terms of side effects and things like that, it's pretty low.
Have you noticed any changes in your body since you have been taking rapamycin?
So I have. I've noticed some improvements in my blood work. I think I'm training better. But I think those kinds of, you know, asking me whether I feel better is not good evidence. I mean, that's anecdotal evidence. And I wouldn't sort of suggest that people listen to me saying that I feel better and saying that's a good thing to do. But I think there's lots of good scientific evidence about it. And I'm very science-based in terms of, you know, these kinds of interventions.
You also prescribe rapamycin to patients to use for longevity purposes. Mm. Is that unusual?
Probably. I think it is unusual. I think my feeling about rapamycin is that the science is good. So I prescribe it for people who specifically generally come to me and they've already, you know, done the research. I'm pretty careful about testing them before they start taking it, and afterwards we keep an eye on their blood work to make sure that, you know, we're not doing any harm. But I'm pretty comfortable prescribing it.
Mm. Lindsay, are there other drugs researchers are looking at to increase longevity?
Yeah, there are certainly a number of compounds under investigation. So rapamycin is clinically available. It's not something that should be taken lightly, as he says. It's used in transplant recipients, and we just need to have those trials. There are other compounds that are also clinically available. So metformin is an anti-diabetic drug that we know from large epidemiological studies seems to be associated with a lower risk of dementia, cardiovascular disease, of course, cancer, and a number of other age-associated diseases. And in fact, there is a big push to test metformin in healthy older people to see if we can delay hospitalisation and poor health. And there are other compounds that, you know, I'm involved in studying that have looked fantastic in rodents studies and are undergoing clinical trials right now, but we're not there yet.
William, would you be interested in taking something like rapamycin or metformin?
Yeah, definitely. Those two are on my list already. I'm trying to get a prescription for those two and a few other ones that are on the blueprint diet.
So that would be a few more pills to add to your pile?
Yes.
Lindsay, in your experience, is there a certain personality type that's drawn to anti-aging studies?
I might get in trouble answering that question. I find that studying the biology of aging is the ultimate frontier in medical science. If we could crack the program of biological aging, we could treat a bunch of diseases. It could have enormous public health benefits. So, you know, there are some people who are motivated by benefits to public health. There are others who are very desperately concerned about their own mortality, and others who are attracted by how popular it's become in the mainstream media. Mm. But yes, there's certainly a couple of personality types that I know.
George, you're 74. Do you ever feel like age is catching up to you?
Not really. I live each day as if it was my last, you know, and one day I'll be right. I just try and have as much fun every day as I possibly can and just look ahead.
You had an operation yesterday as well and you're back on here?
Yes, I mean, let's look at this motor car story. You go and buy a new car and, well, in the olden days, you used to run it in. That's your childhood, you know. You're running it in slowly and then you've got your working life and that's when you work that car over many years. And then the car gets a little bit older and there's got to be a bit of repairs and maintenance on the car. And that's me, right? That's me. And fortunately, you know, the repairs and maintenance happen.
Do you ever think about how many years you might have left?
Yes, I have. I have friends around me dying every day. Well, not every day, but, you know, every month. And so it could be me. Mm. You know, I might die because I get an illness. I might die because I'm in a car accident. So each day, it's got to be a good one.
We've heard that the risk for diseases like Alzheimer's increases with age. What's your approach to possibly being diagnosed with an age-related disease?
I will handle that when it happens. It's not something you want to think about. There are so many good things to think about than to worry about that.
Are you following a health regime to live longer?
My wife makes me follow a sort of a regime, and I cheat whenever I'm away from home.
What do you cheat with?
I like meat. I like red wine. And so I have my fair share of those.
Instead of parking it, I've finished up in the hedge. Oh. And I thought, oh, my God, what's happening here? I said, well, that's it. I can't drive anymore because this is what old people do. My cousin finished up in a chemist shop. he went right through the window.
At the trial, Oscar Pistorius pleaded not guilty.
The story that he came up with was a pathetic, unbelievable story.
I kissed my boy's forehead and promised him that I would get him justice.
Justice at that moment was, you killed my dad, you should lose your life.
If there was a TripAdvisor for the justice system in Australia, in many respects, it would get no stars.
You can't catch me, can you? There are times that you paddle on your own for a while because we're not chatting all the time. Do I go slowly or fast? When you don't keep up, people say, oh, come on, Terry, stop talking, keep going, keep going. Yeah, I'll have to stop. He says, stop, stop, stop.
Terry, you look very comfortable on the water there, but things haven't always been easy for you. What was your life like after your husband died so young, in his early 40s?
Living in Port Moresby at the time, he was working at the university, and he was affected by cancer, throat cancer, and there was no way that he could survive. And at the age of 42, he died, and I was left with 9 children. And they were all with me in Port Moresby. There they are.
Wow. So you're 45 at the time. You've got 9 children living in Papua New Guinea.
Yeah.
What did you do then?
I was teaching at high school full time. Even the day after the funeral, I had classes again. My brother pointed out there was no social welfare, that if I was sick, what was going to happen to all my children and me? And he prompted me to leave and find somewhere more safe for the family. And my colleagues were mainly from Australia. My colleagues said, oh, Brisbane is a good place, nice and warm, because I grew up in the tropics. Mm. And so I was happy to go to a warmer place. And so I applied for a job, and I got the job just like that. And yet, after 10 years in Brisbane at a girls' school, girls' high school, I only took ever 10 days off sick.
Wow.
I mean, my children, they were wonderful.
Wow.
Yeah.
Where did you get the strength to keep going at such a difficult time in your life?
I just accepted what life brought. Worst things happened to me. I mean, the time that I had all these 9 babies within 12 years, I mean, the first 9, the first 8 came within 9 years. And that in England, where the weather doesn't dry your nappies, and we had still the cloth nappies. That was a very hard time, but I accepted it. Then during the war, we were imprisoned by the Japanese for 3 years. Imprisoned, we were in jail and everything. And that was a bad time, but I was in my late teens at the time, from 13 to 17. I was in that Japanese camp, but we made the most of it. We still have jokes among one another, and we just accepted what was happening to us. My mother suffered more because my father and my brother were somewhere else, and we never knew where they were. She suffered more, but I've always accepted what came and made the most of it.
Mm. Joan, you're one of Terry's 9 children. Your mother's led an extraordinary life. What do you think has got her through?
I think her resilience comes from her positive outlook. She always taught us to count our blessings. If things happen that don't go according to plan, don't go as expected, more often than not, they would actually turn out better than you ever thought they would. And the other thing that she's always said is always make sure you can do today what you were doing yesterday. So having that active mind and body, positive outlook, surround yourself with cheerful people. Yeah, and just be positive.
I'm not sulk, and I don't like sulking people either. I sort of try to avoid the sulking people because I don't sulk. Is it because I'm now 95? I don't think so. I think it's just... I've always been active, and I think people also will be aware how important it is that you have to stay friends and make an effort to keep your friends because they will save you and they'll make you live longer.
Kate, you're a geriatrician. Is resilience a factor in living a long life?
Resilience, in a lot of ways, it's a learned skill. Mm. It's not necessarily something we're born with. And so a lot of older people are better at resilience because perhaps they've been through hard things in life, they've got through it, maybe experienced even some growth through it. And so, you know, things can get harder in older age, but they're often great at dealing with that and often have an amazing ability to see what's good in their lives and what's good around them.
Mm. Terry, you've had trouble with your spine, which makes walking quite painful.
Oh, yes.
How has that changed the way you live?
I cannot walk pain-free. Joan bought me a little wheelchair and I thought, oh, no, never. But not long afterwards, I had it because... The doctor showed me the picture of my spine and it's all degenerated at the base of the spine. And she said, there's nothing we can do about it. We cannot stitch it on. And you just have to put up with it. But I wasn't happy with that. And I thought, I took some medication that made me very, 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 very sick. So that was it. I threw all the medication out because it wasn't helping the pain. It was just making me sick with all the side effects. So I'm not taking any of that anymore. But I find that just physiotherapists give me some exercises. And with more exercises, what I feel myself is good for me. I can hobble along and walk with a stroller, but I cannot walk pain-free. And now, so I'm in a pushchair now, and Joan has to push me around. But I've got a scooter, so I can get on my scooter and I can go to the shops and to the hairdresser and to my bridge club. So I can still find myself to where I need to be.
Even though walking is hard for you, you're still kayaking at 95.
Well, kayaking is okay because I'm sitting in the boat and I don't stand on my legs. Mm. So I can do hours. I can do a 3-hour paddle easy. No problem.
And why do you keep wanting to keep going, to keep pushing yourself?
I'm not pushing myself. I enjoy cycling. I was on my bicycle till about 2 years ago when the doctor says, oh, look at your balance, you fall off the bike and you're in a wheelchair. That's what he said. And, of course, Joan was listening in and she said, doctor says Terry is not supposed to cycle anymore. So I had to give up my bicycle and that was terrible. I still miss it. And my car, I mean, just before I lost my bicycle, I lost my car. I had been driving around and... when parking, where there was a car space and there was a hedge here, and instead of parking it, I finished up in the hedge. Oh. And I thought, oh, my God, what's happening here? And then I did it again 3 weeks later. And I finished up in the hedge and I thought, well, that's it. I can't drive anymore because this is what old people do. They felt my cousin finished up in a chemist shop. he went right through the window. And it's a case where you get too old now. It's an old woman syndrome that you do that sort of thing. I honestly didn't know what I was doing. I just finished up in the hedge and the RACQ had to come take my car, finish it up. So I said, no, I'm not going behind the wheel anymore. So I lost my car and I lost my bike, but not the kayak, not my kayak.
Kate, how important is being active and social and funny? how important is that to living longer?
Inactivity is probably the biggest cause of disability in older age in Australia. And it's fantastic. It has found other ways to be mobile and get around. But this can have a really negative impact on life. And it's particularly for women, because women start off with a lower peak bone and muscle mass than men. Then this declines as we get older. So being active is something that's so important to preserve your function. The other part of it is also being social, perhaps even if you don't enjoy the exercise, if you enjoy seeing other people. And these things are just so critical to not just hopefully living for longer, but also enjoying your life in the present. Mm.
Lindsay, you're researching potential drugs that may reduce the impacts of age. How effective is exercise compared to medical interventions?
So I've spent my career developing drugs to hopefully improve healthy ageing. But I would, in my wildest dreams, I could never imagine that we would have anything as effective as exercise. Exercise is extremely effective. And I know lots of people exercise when they're younger to try and lose weight. Just to make it clear to those at home, there are fantastic benefits of exercise to your health independently of losing weight. And for older people especially, resistance training is an incredibly powerful intervention for them.
Murray, in 2021, you woke up in the middle of the night, you had chest pain. What happened?
Well, in the lead-up, we were in our third lockdown. I was probably in my fittest time because we were locked at home. I'd been doing more exercise than I had in a long time. I'd done an hour's workout in the morning, done a 16K bike ride with my family, and just thought, I'm just tired. So I went to bed early that night, woke up around midnight with some chest pain, thought it must just be indigestion. So got up to have a drink of fizzy water. I thought that would be the cure-all, and I would burp and I'd go back to sleep and that'd be fine. That wasn't the case. Went to bed, lay straight back down, just jumped straight back up with the same chest pain and started to get on the ground, turn the TV on and thought, if I just foam roll my back and my chest out, I'll feel much better. My wife came out after maybe 20 minutes of hearing me rolling around on the ground going, what's going on? I said, I've just got really bad indigestion. She said her father had died of a heart attack at 53 years old. She said, do you think you're having a heart attack? I said, don't be silly. How could I be having a heart attack? I'm young, I'm fit, and I'm healthy. She goes, well, I'm calling an ambulance. I said, no, let's just go to the medical centre up the road. The medical centre went, what are you doing here? Put me in the ambulance. Several hours later, I'd had three stents put in my heart.
Wow.
And had a heart attack during the whole process.
Wow. I think it's fair to say then that the heart attack was totally unexpected for you.
Completely unexpected. No family history of heart disease. So, completely out of the blue.
Did the heart attack change how you lived your life initially?
In those first few days after you have a heart attack, you get a lot of home care. So I've been given a lot of advice from the heart specialist and the nurses around that. And we're given some pretty clear guidelines about a new diet regime and a new drinking alcohol regime and maybe an exercise regime, and followed that regime for quite some time.
Did that diet and lifestyle affect your social life?
I have a young family, a small business, and there's a lot of situations that I would get myself into. I coach both my kids' football teams. I do a lot of stuff with the community. I found it very stressful when I'd go into a social situation where there's a barbecue and some beer and red wine and ice creams and those sort of things. There was a lot of load to go and a lot of questions about your heart attack and your health. And so then you feel a little bit, I felt anxious and overwhelmed. And then if you slip, that's when it really keeps you awake at night, that you go, am I going to just fall back down that same thing? Because I had a heart attack out of the blue once. Statistically, I could have another heart attack relatively quickly afterwards.
So that fear of having another one.
Mm.
What approach then did you take to your diet?
More of self-compassion and understanding of how cardiovascular disease can affect your life and longevity in a whole, that it's made up of several facets. A lot of it is lifestyle-related changes around diet, exercise, sleep, social interactions. So I took a bit more of a softly approach. I was a little bit more gentle with myself about some of my decisions, but I set some clear guidelines. If we have 21 meals in a week, I kind of aim to have 18 great ones. I'll let a couple slide. And when I gave myself that freedom to have space, I've actually probably increased my exercise. I make better choices more regularly than I do when I'm trying to hang on to a regime that doesn't fit my lifestyle. And as we know, we've heard today, some of that social interaction is super important. If you feel like you can't interact with people because you're guarding yourself, that second phase of my life has been so much more beneficial. Friends, family have saying, you look so much healthier nowadays than even what I did maybe 12 months ago when I was more restrictive.
So it sounds like you found a balance. Mm. William, how important is balance in your life?
I try to have some social eating every now and then. Can't quite avoid it, but that's only after I still eat the same thing first before I do eat out.
Mandy, do you miss anything that you used to do before your husband William started his diet?
We used to go out a lot, so free meals, we'll go out and eat and try different food. But now that he changed it a bit, where he'll eat his stuff first, so that's a change.
Kate, is it possible to sort of have a middle ground?
Yeah, I think I'm probably much more in the middle ground side of things. And so, you know, working in clinical medicine, you're very aware that even when you do the right things, there's not always guarantees. And that really informs how I live my life. And so I've spent a lot of time looking into the science around diets and how to achieve longevity. And my kind of take, I sort of flip it on its head a bit, is that I'm not willing to put any lifestyle things in that aren't improving my life in the here and now. And a lot of those do actually have longer-term benefits. So I think diet's a really good example. And, you know, sleep is another fantastic example. Now, no one's ever going to do a 20-year randomised controlled trial of making people not get sleep to prove that it protects your brain and things, because that would be cruel. But, again, there's a lot of evidence, observational evidence, that having enough sleep is great for cardiovascular health, great for brain health. But also, you get a good night's sleep and your memory works better, your thinking processes are better, and you just feel better. And I think that it's not realistic for a lot of people to make extremely restrictive changes to their lives in the long term, because deep down we are all, you know, looking for a bit of pleasure. And so I think by flipping it around like that, you can make it more achievable and easier to implement into everyday life.
George, when you were 70, you drove across Africa from Cape Town to Cairo. What made you take such a big trip?
Oh, there's a bit of history in... I was born in Zimbabwe, formerly Rhodesia. There was a guy called Cecil John Rhodes that Rhodesia was named after, and he had this dream when he was governor of the Cape province to build a railway line, Cape to Cairo, and we were taught that in history. And so I thought, well, why not? So I decided to buy myself a four-wheel drive and go.
Wow. Did your age ever become a barrier to travelling like this?
Yes, there was an age problem at 70, and there was nobody in Australia who'd insure me for that trip. I eventually found a company in Holland that insured me. They were expensive, but they were good, and I never needed them.
Along the way, you were camping in Zambia. What happened there?
Oh, I had a wonderful experience. I'd driven into this campsite on the Kafue River, a beautiful spot. I was the only guy on the campsite. Went out on a game drive that afternoon, came back in the evening, lit my fire, cooked myself a meal, opened a bottle of red, and about 9 o'clock I went to bed, and my security were my car keys and an axe, and of course I had a torch in the tent. And the idea was that if an animal attacked me, I'd press the alarm on the car, boop, 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 and chase anything there away. Anyway, that night I fell asleep, and about 3:15 in the morning, I was woken with a lion roaring on the other side of the river.
Wow.
You can hear a lion roar 8 kilometres away. And I realised this was probably about 3 or 4 k's away, and there was a river in between, and cats don't like water, so I was pretty safe. And I dozed off again, and it was calling, and then all of a sudden, right next to my tent, there was a lion roar. Wow! And I was petrified. And it was... felt like it was just there, you know, 5-10 metres away. You know, I felt for my first for the car keys, and they weren't there. I couldn't find them. And then the axe, and that wasn't there. But I found the torch. And, you know, I waited for about 45 minutes, and these two cats were talking to each other, backwards, forwards, roaring, and I was just as quiet as could be. Anyway, the roaring stopped, and for about half an hour just lay still. And then I decided that I better make a dash for the car, the bit of security there. So I unzipped the tent, and you know how much noise a zipper makes in the quiet of the night. Zzzzt! And the torch going looking for these golden eyes, but they weren't there. And I made a dash for the car, into the car, and there was the axe, there were the keys. Of course, I'd had too much wine the night before to remember to bring them into the tent. Anyway, I eventually went back to the tent at about 5 in the morning, lit the fire and got that going, and woke up at about 8:30 and cooked myself a nice big breakfast and said to myself, how lucky to be alive.
What is it like to be facing death sort of head on?
Strangely, it sort of came to me with a sense of calm.
Deep fear. It's been earth-shattering.
Dan, you're following a keto diet to try and live longer. What triggered that decision?
In September last year, I was having the last game of hockey for the season, and the game had only really started for about 5 minutes. All the action was down the other end, and then suddenly I woke up inside of an ambulance. People were telling me that I had a seizure of some kind. Then I fell asleep again and woke up inside a hospital, an emergency department. They looked after me for a few hours and monitored me, then sent me home that night. Following that, an MRI was taken and they found a lesion on my brain.
What were you eventually diagnosed with?
A glioblastoma multiforme. So it's a... brain tumours are pretty rare, but the glioblastoma is probably the most common of the genre. It's pervasive, it's incurable, aggressive, and the prognosis from it was about 14 months.
14 months.
Yeah, from diagnosis. So unfortunately, it also turned out that I wouldn't respond to chemotherapy very well. It meant that really there wasn't a lot that was going to help me with the ongoing standard of care. So the first thing I did was to... They just sort of started the ball rolling, really, and said, well, this is what happens next. You know, we're going to do... We've done the resection. We're going to start you on radiation and chemotherapy for 6 weeks. You'll have a month off and then we'll go on a rolling session of chemotherapy going forward. And so at that time, I knew nothing. It all happened in a bit of a blur. You know, you still... trying to absorb it all before you can make your own decisions. At that point, you just go along with what they tell you to do.
So you received medical treatment initially. Did you decide to keep going with that?
No, I didn't. I guess from the start of this episode, from the very first thing, there was always this unsettled uncertainty because so many things sort of went wrong. It took so long, 3 months to get a final diagnosis, really. They never rang us to tell us what the diagnosis was. We had to remind them that we were waiting and things like that. We had all sorts of things were going on. And so I was always a little bit sceptical that I was getting great care. So I started researching heavily, and what it meant for us was, you know, pretty dismal. Didn't leave a lot to go. The chances of beating the prognosis was something less than 1%. So I just really, whatever capacity I had, I threw into research and started thinking about what it is that I could do differently.
You started your keto diet. How confident are you that that diet could extend your life?
I have no great sense of confidence. I have a great sense of hope. My life is kind of two pathways at the moment. One of them is very much about being mindful of the diagnosis and the prognosis that I've got. And I've made a decision in that space that I have to look after my family first. My wife and I have an adult child with a disability. We have a whole set of support mechanisms around that, which we've built up over time. I now have to unpick all that because I'm responsible for so much of the administration and the works and the business side of things. And I have to... So I've decided that the first 6 months of my time will be getting that in place. That'll be my focus. And then the remaining time that I have left, which is about now when I should be expecting a recurrence of the tumour after following resection, the second timeline I've got is to say, well, I don't accept what this is and I'm going to do whatever I can to beat it.
Mm. Laurie, you're Dan's wife. What was it like to hear about that diagnosis?
It was earth-shattering. We're just told the news that it was incurable, and from that point on, he was in palliative care. So we sort of... what, how, when, left the room. We walked down the corridor, sort of clinging to each other. We sat on the bench outside the hospital doors and we just burst into tears. We just hugged each other and held each other, and I think everyone around us must have thought we were crazy. And then I suddenly realised that my dress was on inside out. And then we started to laugh. And ever since then, it's been a roller coaster ride. It's just been like that. It's been really dark humour has seen us through, you know, deep sorrow, deep fear. It's been earth shattering.
Dan, what is it like to be facing death sort of head on?
Strangely, it sort of came to me with a sense of calm. I don't tend to worry about things that I can't change, and so I stopped worrying about it almost immediately. I started worrying about my family also immediately, but that was really my focus, was worrying about, okay, what happens next to my family? And the first thing that came to me was just about those responsibilities and getting that sorted.
Laurie, how has Dan's diagnosis affect how you feel about your future?
Oh, it's so strange, because a diagnosis like that, the whole focus is on the person who's being diagnosed. But in my quiet moments, I don't really think about my longevity. I actually just think about, we're walking this path together, and we have been a partnership since the day we met. And it's been a bumpy road, it's been a smooth road, it's been all the things that a relationship are. But I just visualise it in my head as if we're going down this pathway, and suddenly there's this big black dot on one of the paths, and that's where I just sort of stop, and I don't really think much beyond that. I know intellectually that I will, should it come to that, I will have to face it. I will have to put one foot in front of another, and I will just have to keep going. I've got a child who depends on me heavily, as well as other children, and I have two beautiful grandchildren who I want to see grow up. But for now and for the short term, I don't think I look beyond just that black space.
Mm. Terry, is death something you think about?
Well, I'm not afraid of death. I know that my husband is helping me through this life. He often identifies himself, but things that I think are going wrong actually turn out to be better than what I was expecting. He's looking after me. And when I die, he'll be there and we'll be together. I do believe in multiple lives. I can't imagine that once the body gives up, that the soul also gives up. I think the soul will continue. And maybe you can have more than one life. I do believe that. And so, no, I don't mind dying. I won't miss my kids, but I'll probably look after them when I'm up there.
William, you said you've been curious about death since you were young.
Yes.
What do you think happens after we die?
I think nothing happens. I would like to believe something happens. It would kind of give me some relief in some ways, but just like before we're born, it's like a void. Nothing happens and nothing will happen.
You've been following a rigorous longevity regime called Blueprint for about 2 months. Have you noticed any changes as a result of this lifestyle?
I wasn't expecting very much changes to begin with, and I haven't noticed anything at all. I think I was quite healthy before, so the changes were not as drastic as if someone were a bit more unhealthy with doing it.
More recently, you've had some medical issues. What's been happening?
Yeah, so I got my blood test results recently, and there was a low count of one of the white blood counts. So I think it was due to the stress, maybe the 2,000 calories or the intense exercises. Could be a wide range of things. So I have started today. I'll be stopping for 4 days, and the doctor said to stop everything and get a test to see if everything's okay, if it's any just a temporary thing or a more serious thing.
If it's temporary, do you plan on returning to the longevity practice?
Yeah, definitely. There's no reason to stop.
Murray, did your heart attack change how you feel about life?
Yes. I don't think about death. That's one thing for sure. I think about my heart attack every day and sometimes multiple times a day. But I think my heart attack has been as much a gift as a curse. It's the thing that motivates me. It's given me perspective. It's given me gratitude about the life that I currently live. But it's given me mostly motivation to stick with the habits that it scientifically proved to help longevity, that when I don't want to get up at 4:30 in the morning to do my breath work, go for a run and go to the gym, I know that if I didn't, I'd slip. So I see the heart attack way more as a blessing and a benefit and a motivator than it was to thinking of death. I still think I'm going to live to 103. Always have.
It's a very specific number.
I don't know why. It's always been in my head. I always say I'm going to live to 103.
Dan, we've been talking about how to extend our lives, but what does a longer life mean to you?
To be honest, if I'm thinking about the life I'm being prognosed as having, it just means taking every moment as it comes along. Smell the roses, enjoy the relationships, enjoy simple things in my home like mowing the lawn and tending the garden, doing some things like that. There's nothing that I can think of in my life where I need to go and climb a mountain or, you know, sail an ocean. I'm grateful for those things.
If you'd known that you would develop brain cancer, is there anything you could have done differently to try and extend your life?
I'm sure there would have been some habits I would have changed. I mean, you kind of know that you're perhaps drinking too much or you're eating too much of the wrong thing. You'll tell yourself you'll fix it tomorrow. Perhaps some more urgency around that would have been might have been something. Mm. But in reality, I haven't got a time machine. It's not a second that's gone past I can recreate and do something. So don't worry too much about what could have been.
Mm. Laurie, do you take the same approach? You look back and think, oh, if these things had been done differently, or do you just live for what you've got now?
Not really. I think probably if there was anything to do differently would just be, I guess, to be kinder to yourself, kinder to others, whether that means adopting a healthier approach to eating or sleeping or exercising, then so be it. But I'm a bit like Dan. I think we've lived a good life and we've been very fortunate to find each other and to be a team. We're a blended family and that's always been interesting. But for me, if you've had the opportunity to love and to be loved, then that's pretty much a good life.
Thank you so much. That's all we have time for. Thank you so much for being in this audience tonight and for you for joining us. You can catch up on this episode or any others on SBS On Demand. I'll see you next time.